Witam Państwa serdecznie w imieniu swoim oraz organizatora, innych organizatorów ze Stowarzyszenia na Rzecz Tradycji i Kultury Niklot. Tym razem nasze spotkanie jest takie trochę nietypowe. Zrobiliśmy je w konwencji spotkania dyskusyjnego nacjonalistów z Europy, którzy przyjechali, znaleźli się w Warszawie, m.in. z okazji jutrzejszego Marszu Niepodległości. Nasze spotkanie prowadzić będzie kolega Miłosz Jezielski. I ja przekazuję w tym momencie już tutaj, że tak powiem, pałeczkę prowadzącego. Proszę.
Witam wszystkich. Spotkanie jest prowadzone w języku angielskim, będzie to nikomu nie przeszkadza. Przy okazji proszę wybaczyć mój angielski, bo szedłem, można powiedzieć, na zamianę. So, okay. The first lecture that we will hear is about the most hot subject in Europe, especially Western Europe. It's about illegal immigration, it's about refugee crisis, it's about creating new identities in Western countries, and this lecture will be spoken by Sebastian Magnifico from Casapan.
My name is Sebastian Magnifico. I'm in charge of international relations for Casapan. Before speaking about immigration, I want to speak a little bit about my organization. So Casapan is not strictly a political party. We like to call ourselves a movement, which means we do what every other political party do. We go on election, we present candidates at any type of election. But we are a movement, which means we handle sport. We have all type of sport activity, from MMA, rugby team, water polo, football, all type of sport, culture. We have an art gallery, we have a theater company. And solidarity, international solidarity. So we intervene in Kosovo and anywhere in the world when needs be. So we were born initially 15 years ago, a very small community, about 15 people initially. And we are known mostly because we started to squat what usually the extreme left does. So we took a full building in the center of Rome, close to the central station, where we are hosting Italian family who are in difficulty. We never meant to be a big organization. Now we have 5,000 members. We have close to 100 different sections across Italy. But initially, we are just born from a simple building in the center of Rome, and slowly, a lot of comrades visited us, and we spread across Italy. It took us about 15 years to arrive where we are now, which means we are present in Italy from way up north in South Tyrol to the south in Calabria, Sicilia. For example, in Bolzano we have four municipal councillors now. And we also have one in Calabria, and at the ultimate election in Rome, we made 1.8%, which is quite a modest score, but we doubled our score. And now let's speak about immigration. It's the most important problem we have in Italy. Other countries like England or France had to face immigration. It started like 30 years ago. Italy was mostly a European country, and also European immigration in the last 5 years. 10 years ago, we had a lot of Polish, Ukrainian coming. Most of the Polish moved back to Poland when the economy got better. But in the ultimate 5 years, we got a huge wave of non-European immigration. To give you an idea, between 98 and 2016, the growth of immigration statistically is 408%. So it's the most severe rise of immigration compared to any other European country. To give give you another number. In the 70s, you had 2,000 Muslims in Italy. Now there are 2 million. So it's a huge number. This phenomenon didn't happen in a spontaneous way. It is planned. In the last 5 years, we had, look at the map of Italy, we are at the center of Mediterranean, so we are one of the doors to enter for immigrants in Europe. With this so-called refugee crisis, people started to come with boats and landed on our shores. The aim is not to live in Italy. Italy has is facing a huge economical crisis. To give you an idea, in Rome we have 47% of unemployment for youth. So Italy is mostly a country of transit. They want to end up in a Scandinavian country, in France, in England, in Holland, in Germany. But some of them, due to drug problem or jail, they will stay in Italy. So right now, the number are about 10,000 refugees, so-called refugees, arriving each month in Italy. It's a huge number. The left, which is leading Italy now, tend to organize a refugee center in the poor neighborhood of each city. This causes a huge type of social problem because those are already neighborhood facing drug problem, unemployment, and they tend to put the refugee center in it. The good aspect is there is one, is the local population, the autochtones, the Italian, are reacting in a not violent way, but extremely angry at this phenomenon. So Casapan decided, obviously, we call ourselves the shield and the sword of Italy. So we want to be on the first line, wherever our population is in need. And right now we are extremely involved. I speak about 20 different type of action a week across Italy. Most of the time it's local people from the neighborhood who know that there is a refugee center which is about to be open, who are coming to us for help to organize themselves. We would not go in a neighborhood without knowing people from the neighborhood. This is it's a cynical politic. If you just come with your flag, you don't belong to the neighborhood, they will, also the Italian will act bad towards you. So once a number of citizens come to us and say we are about to face a refugee center, we will come to their help. Some cases are well known. In July last year, a year and a half ago, there was a refugee center who was about to be opened in the neighborhood of Rome. For 2 months, we blocked the road, night and day. So it's a big involvement at the level of militancy. And after those 2 months, the police decided to raid the blockade we made on the road with the citizen. And 13 policemen were injured, and 16 of our members were arrested. And still today are under some type of restriction, like a signature to the police station, and we are now facing a trial. This case, because of the violence, made the headline on TV, and it was a good occasion to speak about Casapan on the refugee crisis. Typically, the immigrants coming to Italy, they will land by boat. Now the Italian Navy, is taking them next to their shore. So you 2 kilometers away from Italy, instead of bringing them back to Libya, they will bring them to Italy. Well, this has a cost for the Italian citizen because we are paying for all of this. More or less, a refugee will get 30 euro a day, shelter, and a phone, and some pocket money. All those associations managing immigrants are obviously from the left. It's a huge business. Recently, you had a mafia scandal, and police did some interception on the phone. And the mafia among themselves was saying that leave the prostitution, leave the drug business, where the money is immigration. And to make it short, if I start dealing drugs, if I organize prostitution and they catch me, I might get 8 to 10 years in jail. If you manage an association on the immigration money, if you get caught, it's just mismanagement. It's not, you will not go 8 years in jail for this. So for them, it's a huge business. Because of the human right, when immigrants come, you cannot close them like in a jail with barbed wire. So if they refuse to identify themselves, they just say, I'm from Syria. Even if they're from Algeria, Egypt, Eritrea, they tend to declare a country which is at war. It's not their country, but we have no way to track where they're from. And we evaluate that 80 to 90% are not from Syria or countries in war. Typically, Italy cannot handle such a massive immigration, so they tend to close an eye on immigration. Meaning, if refugees come in Italy, and I have like 300 refugees in the center, the police will go get a coffee, leave the door open, the refugee will go to the train station or try to go to Austria. But it suits Italy that the immigrants go away. They don't want to keep them in Italy. And I'm speaking in Poland now, but the big message that should be sent to nationalists across Europe is that the selfishness, the chauvinism of each country will not give an answer to immigration problem. The Serb sending immigrants to the next door country, the Italian sending the immigrants to France. It has to be a European answer to our problem. If not, we will keep on sending the problem away, and our selfishness will like if you're Polish, you say French is invaded. I grew up in France, a lot of comrades from other countries used to tell me, look at the state of France, look what happened, and now they're facing it. They could be Serbs, they could be Hungarians, they could be Italians. So now we are facing a European problem and we need a European answer. We are not at the power of Kazakhstan, we wish to be one day. But one of our points in our political program, because when we speak about immigration, people answer you that it's like the rain, like a storm, like a catastrophe, like something that is not handled by human. We cannot do anything about it, like an earthquake. The truth is that the position of Kazakhstan is that after the Industrial Revolution, all across Europe, from Poland to France to Italy, in one way or another, from the Catholic Church to the Communists, to the Fascists, to the National Socialists, each country tried to face capitalism, modernism in its own way. At the end of World War II, if you take five types of standards, most of European countries had it. Pregnant women go to work, kids have to go to school, some type of pension, some type of hospital. Now, during fascism, which is my organization, take most of its inspiration from the fascist regime, at the time of the fascism, we were promoting autarkia, which means Italy should be autonomous for food, for everything. Right now, we could be thinking about some sort of economical deal that could be made amongst countries that had this type of standard. The fact that we have those women who go to work, kids who go to school, is a product of war amongst Europeans, jail, strikes, violence. And we invite third world country or countries that has not achieved this type of sacrifice to do it. We will not, so you can dream of a type of autarkia amongst those countries. And we will not deal in an equal way with countries which has not done it, like China, India. We cannot compete with countries that put a 5 year old kid. It's not a fair competition. So we invite China and India to do just like our European ancestors did, to fight for their right, to obtain their right. Until it's not done, we cannot imagine an equal type of... So we have two ways of handling it. That's one of our propositions. Right now we are not at the power. What we can do is be on the front line, be a sort of a lobby for our people. Italians are lost, most of the political party, including the communists or the left, have completely abandoned the working class or the poor Italian. And also, Italy should be looked carefully at, for one reason. In Poland, we still have election. In France, they still organize election, left against the right. It's like a theater play on TV. Italy doesn't do it anymore. We have the government for the last 6 years, three types of prime ministers, none of them were elected. They don't even bother to organize election anymore. So it's a complete sort of dictatorship, a soft one, and people don't always believe me. But for the last 6 years in Italy, we never had a chief of state that was elected. So you can imagine the future for Europe. We are part of the European community. You believe it's democratic, we have rules. And the truth is they don't even bother to organize election. So it's extremely critical time. In order to do such a masquerade, you have to make people sleep, the citizen. So drugs, social problems, games, football. Now it's very hard for Italian to wake up. If I speak like this, I sound pessimist. But Dominique Venner, for example, never described European as dead. They say they're sleeping. So it's about, if they're sleeping, they can be waken up. It's true that the time is critical, but I do believe that there is still hope. And it will be part of our job in each country to wake every single European one by one about the dangers that they will be facing. Some of them are already opening their eyes. Casapan is growing. We have a lot of young Italian coming to us as young as 14 years old. In order to attract young to Casapan, we have to play modern way of communication. So we have, for example, music is a good way to attract young Italian. Culture could be one. Literature, sport. So our aim is to have a young member as young as 14 years old sometimes, 13. And maybe in the future, like a scout type of organization from the one who are 7 to 13. And now, if you have a question, I would like to answer you, if anybody has a question.
I have a question about one point of as you said about immigration. We talking only about immigration refugee crisis, but we don't escape from the fact that these people living there from a few generations, and a lot of nationalists, right wingers, think that the assimilation way in Europe they turn them into the Europeans, but in my opinion, it was a mistake. They just created these people another identity connected with their prime roots and newest identity given them by liberal Europeans. What do you think to solve this problem in Europe?
We don't believe in assimilation. I'm not Italian myself. I live in Italy. I respect Italian law. I know Italian history, but I don't want to be called an Italian. And so for me, for example, when I confront myself with immigrants in Italy, it's very easy because I say, you're not Italian, I'm not Italian. But, for example, Dominique Venner again, when he used to define himself, he used to say, I'm a European speaking French, which would make me European speaking French, it could make you a European speaking Polish. And this is also one way. It doesn't mean you negate your national identity or your local one, but if you have a European vision of or imperial vision of Europe, it becomes easier to overcome all the local difficulty we can have amongst each other. And I think it's such a critical time for Europe. We did war amongst each other, all of us, France against Italy, Italy against Austria. But the fact is, we had defeat, we had a victory, and now more or less things are more quiet. But with this type of slow war they are going to do to us, we are slowly dying. And it's a war. You have victims, you have people killing themselves, you have violence in the street, you have rape. So I think the solution is for Europeans to start thinking about a global, a European answer to a problem. Assimilation will never be the solution. You cannot assimilate 10,000 refugees coming each month. They have to go away. So our policy in Casapan is zero immigration. As long as there is one single Italian in the street without job, without shelter, without house, we will not give a single bed to them. As simple as that. We have to handle our own people first, and then, plus, with our system of refugees, we do not help the real refugees. If you think about Christians from Syria, or family, kids, they represent a very, very small minority. Because with the refugees, how do you know you are helping the good one, if there is a good one, the victim? The one traveling have to pay 5,000 euros to cross the Mediterranean Sea. How do you get 5,000 euros in a time of war? Maybe you're one of the bad guys, maybe you're from you're a terrorist, maybe you're a criminal. I think the real victims are still in Syria, and the criminal one might get the money. So we have no way to control their story. Plus, our type of stupidity European, which they taught us to feel guilty about everything. So for example, now they are coming in Italy and they declare themselves homosexual. They say, I'm an homosexual from Niger, I'm an homosexual from Senegal, I'm an homosexual from Morocco. I'm persecuted, I cannot be an homosexual. But how do you control the reality of this story? It's impossible. It's just a declaration. I declare myself homosexual, I want to live in Italy, and they are playing with our law. And we are extremely naive, not us in this room, but European countries are extremely naive when it comes to refugees. Plus, the left are very pragmatical. They say, if you have refugees in Rome, they need food, they need a place to stay. Most of them are men between 17 and 40 years old. If some of you were in the army, for example, if you're a soldier, if you keep sober for a full month without going out, without seeing girls, you will get a lot of problems of discipline. So right now we have 10,000 refugees coming to Rome, and a lot, like in Cologne in Germany, we have a lot of aggression towards women in the street. Late at night, a group of refugees harassing women. And they are hiding the numbers, but I can tell you it's huge.
Tell us please about the situation in Italian official politics. Do you have any contacts there to realize your proposition? Do you try to get this contact?
I missed the first contact of the
Tell about the situation in official politics in Italian. Do you have any politicians supporting your point of view?
Yeah, in the course of the ultimate 15 years, Casapan has made a wide variety of alliances, sometimes interesting ones, sometimes very disappointing. Let's say that the big political party, so-called against immigration, is the Lega Nord, which is a separatist organization from the north of Italy. But first, you have the question of economical issue. Casapan believes that a typical racist from a liberal organization will tell you, I don't want immigrants in the school of my daughter, but he will not challenge the economical system. In Casapan, we took our name from Casapan, who was aware, but he wrote a lot against usury, the bank system, and 80% of what we do is social work. Let's say that for us, the economical issue is the main one. So capitalists bring you immigration, that bring you epiphenomena like mosquée, halal. So for us, we will not challenge only the mosquée or Islamization of our country. We want to challenge the economical system that brings the unfairness and creates this immigration issue. There is no way to solve it if we don't change the way we organize economically. It's not easy to speak to an average citizen in Europe, because I understand an Italian or French guy who was looking at his neighborhood changing the issue of Islamization. But even if they are not Muslim, they could be Christian from Eritrea, it remains a problem. They are not European. So we have to find an economical solution to this problem. It could not be solved the way. So we can imagine we did an alliance with the Legal Nord. It did not bring anything really good so far. We got one deputy elected in the European Parliament, but now we have no relationship with them anymore. It might change. We are very pragmatical. It would mean you don't have to think like Casa Pound to go an election to make an alliance. We can look at the sovereignty, immigration issue. We can find some common battle, let's say. But it has been, we decided recently to strictly present ourselves with our name, our logo, which is a lot easier. And slowly we're getting results.
And what about the social reaction? Does your activities bring you a new blood, new members?
Yes, we get a lot of new members, a lot of media attention. Right now we're opening in more popular neighborhood, difficult one. And recently, like 2 weeks ago, we opened a new one in Rome, which is historically an anti-fascist neighborhood. And right now the anti-fascist section is closed and we are still open. So it was unbelievable 20 years ago. I think the main reason, well, maybe because we are good activists, or that could be an explanation. Let's say that if you're a member of Casa Pound, you will have one meeting on Monday, 3 activities a week, and that's the minimum we ask for you. So when we say 5,000 activists, that really means a lot of activities. I think the extreme left did not provide an answer to the immigration problem, or at least people don't understand the solution to this problem. And they also abandoned the working class battle. They are not on the front line for the organization. They are not on the front line for the black market, the people who are working without contract. And I think they are in the popular neighborhood, even ex-communists are joining us, because with writing like refugees welcome, I defy them to go in a real working class neighborhood from Rome with this type of message. People are fed up, they can't stand it anymore. And last week, this anti-fascist section, this popular neighborhood of Rome, which has been there for 40 years. So, an historical section of the anti-fascist in Rome, they got attacked by the people from the neighborhood, not even Casa Pound. They forced the door, they closed the section, and now they cannot go there anymore. It's true that the people kicking them out are not political activists. Some are criminals, some are regulars, some are average people from the neighborhood. But it gives you an idea of the temper. In many cases, I can do politics in Rome without being harassed by anti-fascists. It's not the case everywhere, but things are getting easier. That's why Casa Pound can speak to anybody. The only discrimination is anti-fascism. And you can find anti-fascists in the extreme right, you can find anti-fascists in the left. Anti-fascism is a value. So, for example, I can speak to a communist and we discuss about globalization, different views of how to organize a state. Anti-fascists, it's impossible to discuss with them, because on the table they put one idea that you should be dead or you should not speak. You have no philosophical ground, political ground to speak. So Casapound, if you want to visit Casapound, everybody is welcome. Anti-fascist is maybe the only border for us.
Organization as well.
of the groups was blamed for terrorism, and two more persons, which were more the closest people to Andrei Belaski, they just were attacked by a governmental provocator, and then they were imprisoned. In media, it was called the case of terrorists from Vasilki. If we talk about first case when guys were blamed for terrorism, and second case was called the case of Rimorska defenders. Rimorska is the street in Kharkiv. It's one of the biggest city of Ukraine. And there was the first fight of our organization. When it came to revolution, not all people supported such idea like European integration of Ukraine and membership of Ukraine in the European Union. But everyone could see that revolution is a chance to liberate our guys from imprisonment and to affect in the situation in country, of course, and fight against the regime of Yanukovych. So, next slide, please. So, our guys also took a part in Maidan. And they said that we take a part, but we are not for European integration. We fight against the regime of Yanukovych, against political repressions, against corruption among policemen. So we want to destroy this regime and leave us normal people. So once the revolution was ended and conflict in Crimea has started, there was a decision to create a partisan squad, Black Corps. I forgot to tell that as a result of revolution, our guys were liberated and they moved to Kharkiv to fight with separatists which tried to create these quasi-republics in Kharkiv, Donetsk, and Lugansk. So first idea of Black Corps, like partisan, as partisan formation, was to conduct underground operations in Crimea. But there was such a situation that first pro-Russian activity began in the Donbas. So there was a decision to move there and fight first time as a partisan organization, completely illegal, but later as a battalion Azov. When Azov was created, there was also a decision to create a civil organization which will fight with separatism and other problems in peaceful areas. So, in 2014, Andrei Belaski gave us order to create a civil organization, and our first time it was to help the front to provide different assistance for soldiers, but later, as the idea of civil corps was changed, and now this organization fights against separatism in peaceful areas, against gambling, drug trafficking, and also conduct different social activity, ecological activity, and also different educational projects like book publishing. Conducted different meetings with modern writers, especially from nationalist environment. And so, next slide, please. Military operations of Azov. Here I wrote three of the most successful operations. In first battle, Azov captured the Minister of Defense of the so-called Donetsk People's Republic. It was first success because guys didn't have any normal guns and they could have captured this the most important person of that time in the terrorist environment. Second, our military success was liberation of Mariupol. It's a very important strategic city because it allows us to control the sea and also control the most of eastern region. This city was liberated by Azov regiment without losses on our side. We didn't lose any person in this fight. And third, it was counter-offensive operation in Shirokino. There was such a situation that Mariupol was shelled by artillery and grads, so there was a big threat to the city and also there was threat that separatists will start offensive in the direction of Mariupol. So Andrei Bilensky and the rest of leadership of regiment, they made the decision that there is a need to conduct a counter-offensive operation in Shirokino and capture this village. So it was one of the in our military history, modern Ukrainian military history, it's first successful counter-offensive operation. Right now people, participants of this operation even wrote the book Operation in Shirokino. So, next slide, please. On this picture, we see the capture of this Minister of Defense of Donetsk People's Republic. Here, on this picture, Andrei Bilensky, leader of the regiment, during the liberation of Mariupol. And the picture below, it's a photo from the operation in Shirokino. Next slide, please. As for our international policy, Azov conducts international politics in Polish-Ukrainian direction and also with other Eastern and Central European countries. Here you can see the pictures from the conference which had a place in Kyiv, 2nd and 3rd of July, which was called the Intermarium as a geopolitical alternative for Eastern and Central Europe. Next slide, please. 14th of October 2016, Azov became a political party national corps. Here is a picture from party congress and there is an version of formation of party which was called the March of a Nation. It also was in Kyiv. I see the people here who took a part as well. So next slide, please. There are also photos from party congress. Andrei Bilensky, he was chosen as a leader of a party for the next 4 years. Thank you for your attention, and now we move to the presentation of short movie about a civil corps as an organization and its activity in Ukraine. If you have some question connected to with our international policy and especially Intermario, I am open to discussion, so ask your questions. We can discuss it after the film or before the film, as you wish.
After.
Okay, let's discuss it after.
there is some questions about other movements for class.
As you may ask in Polish or English, as you want. Maybe you have some questions about our Polish-Ukrainian relations, because we made a lot of steps in this direction and we have first success.
I potem rozmawiałem z tymi studentami, bo przez 5 dni można
Francji i Wam na pewno pomoże w sporze z Rosją, co moim skromnym zdaniem jest czystym złudzeniem. I chciałbym, żeby Pan skomentował, czy to jest tylko moja taka skrzywiona optyka, czy rzeczywiście ta naiwna wiara w pomoc krajów Unii jest powszechna wśród młodzieży ukraińskiej.
No na samym początku jeszcze, kiedy się zaczęła rewolucja, taka wiara naprawdę była. Wszyscy tam krzyczeli, Ukraina to jest Europa i różne takie rzeczy. Ale kiedy już zaczęły się walki na Majdanie, a przedstawiciele Unii Europejskiej mówili, że musimy powstrzymać przemoc, to już takie nastawienie, pojawiło się takie bardziej nastawienie negatywne. A dalej już, kiedy zaczęła się wojna, i Europa zawsze mówiła, że musimy podpisać jakiś nowy plan pokojowy, w wyniku którego straciliśmy więcej terenu, więcej życia żołnierzy, to teraz powiedzmy takie nastroje wobec Unii Europejskiej bardziej negatywne, ale też są osoby, które nastawione pozytywnie.
A w procentach był Pan w stanie jakoś?
W procentach ciężko mi powiedzieć. W filmie mi nie spodobało się, bo Na ten temat niestety, jak i w Polsce, tak i w Ukrainie jest bardzo wiedzy. Że dużo Polaków, no my naprawdę wierzę, że Bandera i Szukiewicz osobiście chodzili po Ukrainie i zabijali Polaków. I teraz na przykład noszą niektóre osoby tam koszulki z przekreślonym portretem Bandery, ale bardzo mało osób naprawdę wie, że bezpośrednio sprawcą zbrodni był Dmytro Kleczkowski, czyli Klim Sałów. I na ten temat bardzo mało wiadomo. Mi się wydaje, że najpierw musimy o tym dyskutować po obie strony granicy i wyrabiać jakiś wspólny pogląd na historię.
Tak. U was tak, że historia w kinie czy w literaturze jest zakłamana, tak? Co pan powie na temat filmu Żelazna Sotnia?
Powiem szczerze, niestety nie oglądałem tego filmu, żeby skomentować.
To jest jeden z najbardziej takich typowych ukraińskich filmów o wydźwięku antypolskim. Autor tego filmu, już nie pamiętam jego nazwiska, nakręcił także o Stepanie Banderze i Szuchewiczu. To jest cały... trylogia filmów i Żelazna Sotnia właśnie jest najbardziej antypolskim filmem ukraińskim.
Nie, no nie mogę tego filmu komentować, bo szczerze powiem, nie oglądałem niestety go.
No jeżeli film Wołyń kontra Żelazna Sotnia, to Wołyń jest bardzo, że tak powiem, nie ma tam takiego wydźwięku antyukraińskiego, jak na przykład w takim typowym filmie jak Żelazna Sotnia antypolskim.
No, żeby komentować, to muszę obejrzeć. No, jeżeli chodzi o filmy Wołyń, to z takich elementów propagandy, co założyłem, to ta scena poświęcenia morze Siekier, to nawet Grzegorz Motyka, polski historyk, udowodnił, że tego nigdy nie było, ale w filmie niestety ta scena jest obecna. No, jeżeli chodzi o rekrutację młodych osób do UPA, to dzieci tylko używali jako wybór, na przykład pójść tam do wsi, sprawdzić, ile jest bolszewików, czy kogoś innego, ale dzieci nigdy nie brali udziału w partyzanckich działach. Ich nie było tam. To taki też element propagandy. Ale tak, moim zdaniem film jest bardzo obiektywny, historyczny, tylko trzeba dopracować tą część no, o takich przyczynach ukraińsko-polskiego konfliktu.
Jeżeli nikt nie ma, to ja chciałbym się zapytać o pewien aspekt, nazwijmy to geopolityczny u was. Wiadomo, że są w szeregach batalionów ochotniczych, bo to nie tylko Azov, ale także Ajda na przykład, ochotnicy z Rosji narodowości rosyjskiej.
Tak.
Czyli rosyjscy przeciwnicy imperializmu moskiewskiego, powiedzmy, tak? Notabene miały tu być jakieś osoby, no, właśnie takie z Rosji, które są przeciwnikami tymi, ale o ile wiem, nie dojechały. I moje pytanie jest takie, na ile oni są jakoś reprezentatywni dla etnonacjonalizmu rosyjskiego, tak? Bo oni są u was, że tak powiem, z pozycji narodowej. Oni uważają, że imperializm rosyjski szkodzi samym Rosjanom, tak? I że to Rosjanie powinni go odrzucić. Moje pytanie jest takie, czy to jest jakiś margines, czy jest to wskazówka pewnej szerszej tendencji, jak to należy postrzegać według pana?
Jeżeli chodzi o rosyjskich nacjonalistów po stronie ukraińskiej, no, kiedy się zaczęła wojna na wschodzie, to środowisko nacjonalistyczne w Rosji bardzo podzieliło się na takich zwolenników Putina i zwolenników Ukrainy. No, dużo na przykład osób, które uważały się nacjonalistami, pojechały walczyć po stronie separatystów, którzy otwarcie deklarują takie rzeczy, jak tam na przykład odwoływanie do tradycji radzieckiej, co dla tego nacjonalizmu no, nie może mieć nic wspólnego. No. I jest taka strona nacjonalistów, która walczy po naszej stronie i tworzy emigrację polityczną. Przykład teraz została założona taka organizacja jak Ruski Centrum. To jest emigracja polityczna rosyjskich nacjonalistów, którzy są przeciwko reżimowi i walczą po naszej stronie na wschodzie. No, dużo takich intelektualistów wśród nich jest. Głównie inteligencja wyjeżdża, ale także członkowie subkultur.
A czy można powiedzieć coś o ich bazie społecznej? Czy są jakiekolwiek badania?
Ile ich jest?
Tak, w Rosji.
W Rosji? W Rosji głównie to oni są bardzo mocno zakonspirowani, bo tam nawet za symboliki Azowa jest już artykuł niestety. Więc można trafić do więzienia. Tylko za to, że masz tam na przykład koszulkę Azowa czy problemkę. Tak.
Bo ja jestem wraz ze stworzystwa na tych biury. No i teraz takie pytanie mam do pana. No, ideologia Azowa, jak mi się wydaje, bardziej pacha na Węgrzech. Ona nie ciężka była. A on właśnie był przeciwnikiem Międzymorza. A kultura, że na francuskie to byli jak najbardziej, tak. To czemu Azowi może zmienić ideologię? Na przykład sztyciurę, na przykład, a nie na przykład bandiary, no to jakby nie za bardzo to odpowiada na przykład.
Jeżeli chodzi o ideologię, to mieliśmy kiedyś dyskusję na ten temat. Azow, główna postać historyczna w Azowie to nie Bandera czy Szuchiewicz. Główna postać historyczna to książę Światosław. Mieliście okazję w filmie zobaczyć tam pomnik, który zrobiliśmy na Mariupolu. Jeżeli chodzi o ideologię, do której odwołujemy się, to Azow odwołuje się do pracy ideologicznej Mikołaja Ciborskiego, Nacjokracja, który był członkiem UNM i zabity przez banderowców, przez sekcję UNB. My budujemy pod swoją ideologię na jego pracę Nacjokrację. Jeżeli chodzi o takim światopoglądzie, to głównie na podstawie prac Doncowa i też takiego historyka ukraińskiego, który był zamordowany przez komunistów, Jurij Lepa, który też był nas mocno próbował w Międzymorze. Ale u nas to było pod tytułem Doktryna Czarnomorska. Czyli nie mogę powiedzieć, że my jesteśmy tam stricte probanderowski. Jeżeli chodzi o organizacje, które odwołują się swojej ideologii do Bandery, używają odpowiednie kolory, to chodzi o prawym sektorze, który przedstawia taki nurt, bardziej klasyczny nurt ukraińskiego nacjonalizmu. My już patrzymy głębiej i tak powiedzmy globalnie. Więc ideologia, oczywiście cały czas ideologia się zmienia. Nawet można zauważyć, że jest bardzo duża taka zmiana w ukraińsko-polskim kierunku. Bo też był taki w Polsce popularny mit, że Azow jest stricte antypolski. Co nam z kolegami w Polsce udało się zmienić dzięki też rektorom szturmu.
Okay. The lectures is ended, I think. And now we will have, of course, we need to thank you for our guests from Ukraine.